Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Hellenic Centre. Καλώς ορίσατε, and Happy New Year. I am Agatha Kalisperis, the director, and I'm delighted to see you all at this very special event, and it's our first in the new year. Throughout 2018, we have a very rich cultural program, and I hope to see you all again in the near future. Today's event, it's part of a two-day event co-organized with King's College, London, and is under the auspices of the President of the Hellenic Republic, Mr. Prokopios Pavlopoulos. The second day, tomorrow, is an all-day event taking place at King's. The program that you, there was at the entrance, this big program at the entrance, and also the leaflets on your chairs, give all the details about the speakers, the artists, the musical program, and the supporters. You'll have later, hopefully, to see the exhibition in this room, and I think it's brilliant. It's one of the best exhibitions we had, and it's the hard work and many years of work of Mrs. Stefanos Gerulanos. Tomorrow it will be also open all day, the exhibition, if you would like to come and see it when it's quiet. Can I ask you all please to switch off your mobile phones? Usually I show you the exits. Our exits at the back and the way you came. Okay, enjoy the evening and let's welcome our first speaker, Bethany Hill.
Thank you so much. What a total delight and honour it is to be here this evening. There is such a wealth of scholarship and music tonight that I really am just going to say a very, very few words to kick off the evening. Many of you here will know that I am a great supporter of the work of the Hellenic Centre. I am, I think it is true to say, a great Hellenophile. I am not, however, an expert in Cavafy and his work. I am instead a passionate amateur devotee of the poet. And I'll explain just one of the reasons why. When I'm writing my history books, I always try to put these little epithets at the beginnings of the chapters. And I find, time and time again, I go through every kind of source, ancient and modern, and almost without exception, actually, when I'm trying to find word ideas that illuminate and encapsulate history, it's to Cavafy that I turn, because his words are just so searing, so sensuous, so salient, so sublime. They tell us not just about the present and the future, but about the shared past of all of us. So I love Cavafy, and I know that he is indeed a great lover of the project of creating history and sharing history with a wider world. So it's absolutely appropriate that tonight Cavafy's connection to history is being interrogated and amplified and celebrated with all of us. It's absolutely right that we should think about him as a lover of history. Tonight, as I've said, there are going to be other experts who are speaking. I'm not here. I'm often here as a speaker. Tonight, I'm not. But I just want to venture one idea and share one thought with you. The last time I was here at the Hellenic Centre, just before Christmas, we had a lovely evening when we talked about the power of these beautiful Greek word ideas, memory and harmony, and how they're ideas that last through time. And we kind of investigated all kinds of ways that memory play out in the world. I hope that Cavafy himself would be interested in the scientific discoveries that we made, that neuroscientists now tell us that we are physiologically creatures of memory, that we carry memory right across our brain, that we cannot have a future idea, we cannot think about the future unless we access a memory or a past experience of some kind. And it feels to me that's partly why instinctively Cavafy stitched history throughout all of his work. So memory and harmony matter. But there is another beautiful Greek word idea that some of you will know I champion and talk about and have made radio programs about, and that is, of course, xenia, this notion of guest-host friendship, of the friendship of strangers as well as of friends. What some of you might not know is that etymologically there's a very interesting root that we can trace back of this word xenia, that it starts out life 5,000, 6,000, 7,000, possibly 8,000 years ago as a Proto-Indo-European idea, gosti, G-H-O-S-T-I. And that word, gosti, comes down to us through the Anglo-Saxon root as the words guest and host, the idea that they're one and the same thing. But it's an extraordinary notion, gosti and xenia. It's this notion that I think is at the foundation of civilization, that it's down to us to always welcome the strange, the unknown, across our borders, across our hearths. So how we think that gosti actually worked in the story of civilization is that when men and women saw a stranger on the horizon, rather than automatically pick up their weapons and think that that stranger was coming to steal their women, to steal their livestock, to steal their ideas, they took the risk of welcoming that stranger across their threshold because it brought new ideas, new goods, new influences to their core. And it feels to me that that is the story of civilization, and that Cavafy, in his work, is the incarnation of that incredibly ancient idea of xenia and gosti. Because Cavafy does so many things, he does so much to cross borders and boundaries. He goes beyond the border of the obvious. He champions those at the edge of things, the quiet voices, the voices that we might not expect to focus on and to immortalise. And so Cavafy, I think, is, for me, an incarnation of that idea of xenia. And also, if I can just say, some of you will also know that I've spent 10 years writing a book about Constantinople, Istanbul. I've just been shown the Greek copy, which has a mistake in it, so I'm going to go straight on to my publisher and get that corrected. But Cavafy, of course, had his parents were from Constantinople. He spent time there. And I just wonder if the influence of that lovely city, which has had and is still having very dark days, but that at its best was a city that welcomed in new influences, new ideas, whether that city had a great influence on him and his work and encouraged him to be the open-minded, extraordinary, creative genius who lives in many times at once that he was. So I just offer to you that Cavafy is wonderful for so many reasons. He nourishes what it is to be human. I go to bed every night with a volume of Cavafy next to my pillow. And I think why we should all love him and why the work of this conference is so great is that it nourishes not just the poet, not just his work, not just his ideas, but that essential sense that we should all try to be at our very most essential point, cosmopolitan. Because Cavafy tells us how important it is to love living in the world, as Socrates said, not just to love life, but to love the living of it, and to be true and effective world citizens. So I say thank you to the Hellenic Centre for hosting this evening. Thank you to everyone in this room who loves Cavafy. Thank you.
Before I introduce Professor Tsouklos, I would like to thank Bethany Hughes and give her something small with thing inside written for her, Tassa ek ton son si prospero. Most of the Greeks that take the Holy Communion know what this means. I offer you what is yours and belongs to you. It's her book in Greek that she hasn't seen. So let's separate. On page 90, there is a picture inside, which is of a little coin, which is here, which is written on Byzantion with omega at the end. And it has the crescent and the star, the Turkish flag. It is something that shows everybody when I'm going to Turkey, it is more than united that divides us. They have the flag, and it's the Byzantine, the flag of the town, of the city of Byzantium before it became Constantinople. And that's something that I would like to offer you. And now I have to do my duty and to introduce you the director of the of Athens Conservatoire, as they say it in English. I don't know why it was at that time the official language, foreign language, was French, and it's approximately 150 years. It was a disaster for many, many years, a catastrophe with graffiti, etc., from the moment that Tsouklos and Athenaeus took over. They have completely changed the whole thing, and that's why we are here to celebrate music and poetry, like last year, but this time more offered to Cavafis. He was before the chief of the Megaron and has a huge experience in the administration of centers like that. May I ask Professor Tsouklos to take the podium?
Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, this is the second chapter of Sounds of the Hellenic World and the third common venture between King's College and the Athens Conservatoire in what evolved to become an extremely constructive long-term collaboration of our two institutions. For this, on behalf of the Athens Conservatoire, I would like to extend my warmest thanks both to Professor Roderick Beaton and to our extraordinarily efficient Paulina Tambakaki. And of course, nothing would have been possible without the tireless care of Nada Yerulanos, whom I personally thank for everything she does in the Athens Conservatoire. I'm particularly happy to inform you that, thanks to our common efforts, the printed proceedings of the first collaborative event between King's and the Athens Conservatoire, which took place 3 years ago in Athens with the help of the British School at Athens, will be shortly presented along with a new recording comprising unknown musical works recently rediscovered in the Athens Conservatoire archives. And now to today's evening. It occurred to me that, as is often the case when dealing with the works of Cavafy, the concept of time and its various manifestations will be somehow constantly present all through our proceedings. Therefore, in fulfillment of the promise I gave for a very, very brief introduction, I would like to propose this fleeting concept of time as a latent unifying principle, a sort of common musical counter-subject of our shared reflections on Cavafy this evening. The elderly poet experiences the earthly passage of time as a trauma. The aging of my body and my beauty is a wound from a merciless knife, says Jason Cleander, poet in Comagene, 595 AD. While writing about the passage of time and its consequences, Cavafy uses the historical distance between the then of a distant past and the now of his own voice, thus softening the sharpness of the possessive pronoun, the aging of my body and my beauty. This verse is presented to us not as a personal confession we know it in reality to be, but as the echo of the voice of an ancient poet who is no more, or more accurately, who has never been. Jason Cleander is apparently a fictional character. We thus found ourselves witnessing a double use of the idea of passing time: aging as the principal theme of the verse, and a reference to a fictional historical past as a technical means of establishing poetic distance. This way of using historical time somehow reminds me of the sfumato technique used by Renaissance painters, which consisted in artfully blurring the sharpness of their contours in order to give additional volume and depth to their enigmatic figures. Obviously, this poem, The Melancholy of Jason Cleander, is but a small example of the centrality of the historical dimension in the poetry of Cavafy. Later on, we'll certainly learn much more on the fascinating subject of Cavafy's relationship with history, and in particular, his secret historical chronology, from Professor Yerulanos, who also presents this marvelous exhibition of ancient coins and other artifacts related to Cavafy's poems. and to whom we also owe the beautiful book which is being presented here this evening. In Cavafy's universe, poetry is allocated a special function. If not healing the passage of time, it is at least consoling the melancholy resulting from it. Bring your drugs, art of poetry, they numb the wound at least for a little while, says the same Jason Cleander. Here, poetry offers a sort of provisory refuge away from the personal drama of the aging body, while Cavafy expertly reverses his play with the idea of historical time. Thus, by celebrating poetry's consoling powers, the previously established fictional historic distance between the imagined past of an ancient poet and the present of Cavafy's own voice, is in effect cancelled. The otherworldliness of poetry's refuge turns it into a common locus for both fictional past and actual present. Professor Metaxas will tell us more in a while about this idea of spatio-temporal refuge in Cavafy's poetry. From our own point of view of a musician, not especially expert, although poetic things, although an amateur, fanatic amateur of Cavafy, I am reminded of the fact that a very similar function, this of an atemporal refuge, has been repeatedly claimed by musicians for their own art. I can offer two examples of such claims coming from totally different contexts. The great Arab philosopher Al-Farabi, who lived from the end of the 9th to the middle of the 10th century, argued that music reinvigorates from exhaustion because exhaustion is caused by the sense of time born from movement, while music can make us lose the sense of time. Much nearer to us, I'm quoting from the recent beautiful book by John Eliot Gardiner on Bach, where reference is made to the following description by Milan Kundera of the intrinsic elusiveness of the present moment. In the course of a single second, our senses of sight, of hearing, of smell, register, knowingly or not, a swarm of events, and a parade of sensations and ideas passes through our head. Each instant represents a little universe, irrevocably forgotten in the next instant. All the sadness of life lies in that fact. End of quote. To this, the musician John Eliot Gardiner replies, "The miracle of music is that it allows us to step aside momentarily from Kundera's temporal evanescence." In both of the above examples, the art of music is described as offering a sort of atemporal refuge, very similar to that attributed by Cavafy to the art of poetry, a good opportunity to reflect upon the poetic potential of music and, most importantly for us this evening, upon the intrinsic musicality of Cavafy's poetry. The composer Dimitri Mitropoulos composed a musical version of a selection from Cavafy's erotic poems, which we'll have the privilege of hearing later on by Angelika Kathariou and Thodoris Tzovanakis. And these works might surprise on their first hearing. To quote from Haris Xanthoudakis' introductory note in the complete edition of the 14 Inventions, in his work on Cavafy, Mitropoulos refuses any programmatic or descriptive elements of any sort of romantic rhetorics, but opts instead for the distanced feeling which results from the use of morphologic types taken from Baroque music and inserted in a generalized atonic polyphonic idiom, something which relates this work to the neoclassicism of Stravinsky and its contemporaneous new objectivity. Mitropoulos himself describes his songs on poetry by Cavafy as artistic mathematical calculations with sounds and words. Here, it is the outer shape of the poems, the complex form of the verses taken as such, which guides the composer's creation, a fascinating modernistic procedure in which, to quote again Xanthoudakis, the music remains emotionally inert, in full contrast to the passion which underlies the erotic reminiscences expressed in the poems, and which triggers the emotional response of the dedicated listener. Could we not see here, in this emotionally inert, neoclassical musical gesture, where past forms converse with contemporary idioms and ideas, a hidden similarity to the technique of temporal distance the poet so often utilizes in his historical poems? Would not this musical formalism be offering yet another atemporal poetic shelter against the melancholy of erotic reminiscence? If so, the dedicated listener will surely recognize Mitropoulos's compositional gesture on Cavafy as being perfectly in tune with the poet's spirit. I was mentioning dedicated listening. Such dedicated listening is an absolute prerequisite in the exceedingly demanding process of a poetic translation. Listening not only for the musical rhythm of the verse and for its poetic meanings, but also offering an attentive ear to the linguistic particularities of an exquisite poet working in the linguistic environment of a past time. Thus, hidden deep inside the delicate creative process of transposing Cavafy's complex creation from its original linguistic tonality to a novel one, we encounter yet again historical time and historical distance as a crucial poetic element. On the ways of such transposition, as proposed by Evangelos Sakperoglou, we'll soon have the privilege of hearing Professor Makrich. With that, I think it's time I leave the microphone to Professor Metaxas. Thank you for your attention.
Κυρίες και κύριοι, καλησπέρα σας. Πολλές ευχαριστίες για την πολύ τιμητική πρόσκληση. Το θέμα που θα ήθελα να μοιραστώ μαζί σας έχει ως τίτλο «Ο χωροχρονικός εξωτισμός του Cavafy, το ταξίδι του σε άλλους χώρους και σε άλλους χώρους και τόπους». Θα σας παρακαλούσα, αν συμφωνείτε, να μεταφερθείτε νοερά στο τέλος του 19ου αιώνα. Γιατί αν ο 20ος αιώνας είναι μία ομιλία και ένας χώρος όπου υπάρχει μία αισθητική διεκδίκηση μιας γνησιότερης ελευθερίας, αυτός ο 20ος αιώνας στον οποίο είμαστε σήμερα προϋπάρχει και τρέφεται από το 19ο. Είναι κάτι που δεν μπορεί να αγνοηθεί. Και προϋπάρχει και τρέφεται γενικά στην τέχνη, στη ζωγραφική, στη ποιήση, στη μουσική, αλλά και στις επιστήμες, από τις οποίες κατατίθενται επερωτήσεις, μερικές φορές οξύτατες, χωρίς να παίρνουν πάντα τις ικανοποιήσεις που μερικοί νομίζουν. Όμως, η αμφισβήτηση των παγιοποιημένων νομιμοτήτων, ακαδημιών, σχολών, σαλών, αλλά και άλλων θεσμοθετημένων, αδειοδοτημένων, αν θέλετε, πολιτισμικών συλλογικοτήτων, δεν εκδηλώνεται από όλους, εκδηλώνεται μόνο από κάποιους. Η ευρεία κοινωνία, τόσο η ανώνυμη, όσο και η επώνυμη, δεν φαίνεται να μετέχει στους εγερτικούς στοχασμούς εκείνης της περίοδου. Αυτοί οι κάποιοι, λοιπόν, οι λίγοι, καλλιτέχνες, μουσικοί συνθέτες, που δεν γνωρίζουν πάντα ο ένας τον άλλον, αναζητούν με μία συχνά εντυπωσιακή κοινή φρασιολογία, για να χρησιμοποιήσω αυτή τη λέξη από τον Cavafy, τη δικαίωση της αλήθειας τους, της κάποιας αλήθειας τους. Και την ψάχνουν, όπως στον τίτλο αναφέρθηκα, σε άλλους υποθετικούς χώρους και χρόνους, φανταστικούς ή μερικές φορές και φαντασματικούς.
Σε αυτή την κατηγορία ανήκει ο Κάπαπι Καβάφης με τα δικά του κρυσφύγετα, μέσα στα οποία προσπαθεί να διασωθεί. Έτσι λοιπόν έχουμε μία απόπειρα υπαρξιακής ανυπακοής και αναζήτησης, η οποία δείχνει να υποστασιοποιείται στη δική του ποίηση, ένα κεφάλαιο του αιρετικού λόγου, δεν είναι το τελευταίο για εκείνη την περίοδο αλλά και στη συνέχεια, με την οποία, αν θέλετε, ποίηση τι γίνεται, αμφισβητούνται οι κοινωνικοπολιτικές χριστιοποιήσεις εκείνης της εποχής, αλλά και της κάθε εποχής. Χρησιμοποιώ τον όρο θρησκειοποίηση όταν κάτι δεν προτείνεται ως αμφισβήτηση, αλλά προτείνεται ως αποδοχή και πίστη. Μία αντίληψη απέναντι στην οποία ο ποιητής δεν είναι τόσο θετικός. Έχει ένα δικό του σημειωτικό σύστημα, αν και νομίζω ότι αν άκουγε σήμερα να του απονέμουν την ιδιότητα του συστήματος, δεν θα ήταν καθόλου σύμφωνος, λαμβανομένη υπόψη ότι η λέξη σύστημα είναι από καλλιτεχνική άποψη, αν θέλετε, ένα σκληρός, βάρβαρος όρος και δεν θα τον δεχόταν. Εν τούτης όμως υπάρχει μία λογική. Και βέβαια σε αυτή τη λογική ο Καβάφης προσπαθεί να προτείνει τις δικές του ηθικές στρατηγικές της κοινωνίας και το κάνει γιατί πιστεύει ότι αυτές οι ηθικές στρατηγικές είναι ελλείπουσες. Ως εκ τούτου βρισκόμαστε μπροστά σε μία κριτική διαμαρτυρία. Και κάτι ακόμα θα ήθελα εισαγωγικά να θυμίσω, ότι μέσα σε κάθε ποίημα αυτού του φιλοσόφου, μέσα σε κάθε φράση μερικές φορές, ακόμα και μέσα σε μία λέξη, συνυπάρχει ένα μεγάλο μέρος της ποίησής του. Ο Καβάφης είναι σε κάθε λέξη του πανταχού παρόν ως όλο. Ποιες είναι τώρα αυτές οι στρατηγικές αξίες, οι οποίες υποστασιοποιούνται κάθε φορά με έναν επιτίδιο ρυθμό, ανάλογα με την ένταση που θέλει να δώσει και την αμφισβήτηση με την οποία αυτή την ένταση ταυτόχρονα θέλει να υπονομεύσει. Θα μπορούσαμε να τις διακρίνουμε σε δύο μεγάλες κατηγορίες. Είναι πρώτα απ' όλα όλες εκείνες που αφορούν την κοινωνική μας ευθύνη, όλων μας, τόσο την ατομική όσο και τη συλλογική, και είναι και οι άλλες με τις οποίες ο Καβάφης σχετικοποιεί και τη ρηματικότητα του λόγου του και την ουσία των πεποιθήσεών του. Και βεβαίως με αυτόν τον τρόπο πλήττει τις απολυτότητες και τις πίστης. Θα μπορούσα παραδειγματικά, και αυτό θα κάνω, να αναφερθώ σε ορισμένους λοιπόν χωροχρονικούς υπενιγμούς του, από τους οποίους αντλείται και διαγράφεται όλη του η φιλοσοφία. Ο πρώτος, τον οποίο τον γνωρίζουμε όλοι, είναι ο εγκλισμός. Ο Καβάφης είναι εναντίον κάθε περίφραξης. Και το ξέρετε όλοι, διότι πράγματα πολλά έξω να κάμω ήχον. Α, όταν έκτιζαν τα τείχη, πώς να μην προσέξω. Ανεπαισθήτως με έκλεισαν από τον κόσμο έξω. Για να ακολουθήσει, στα 1898, το δεύτερο ιδρυτικό ποίημα, το «Περιμένοντας τους Βαρβάρους», που εδώ με αυτό το ποίημα περνάει όλο το πρόβλημα της ρωμαϊκής ιστορίας και της πτώσης της αυτοκρατορίας, όπου όλες οι εξουσίες υποχωρούν μπροστά στο ενδεχόμενο
να φτάσουν επιτέλους οι βάρβαροι εντός πολλών εισαγωγικών όπου μήπως μας δώσουν κάτι καινούριο. Αυτή η προσφυγή προς το άλλο είναι χαρακτηριστική σε όλη την ποίηση του Καβάφη, γιατί έτσι ο ποιητής μας αμφισβητεί την δυνατότητα μιας και μόνης ταυτότητας της ρωμαϊκής, της ελληνικής ή της οποιοσδήποτε άλλης, της οποιασδήποτε άλλης, με συγχωρείτε, να ανταποκριθεί στις ανάγκες ορισμένης εποχής. Και βεβαίως το ποίημα το ξέρετε όλοι, αλλά εκείνο το οποίο έχει κάποια σημασία, ίσως και μεγαλύτερη, είναι το ακόμα πιο γνωστό, το καταληκτικό, και τώρα, τι θα γίνουμε χωρίς βαρβάρους. Οι άνθρωποι αυτοί ήσαν μια κάποια λύση. Η επιφύλαξη βρίσκεται στο κάποια, δεν είναι η λύση, είναι μια κάποια λύση. Μένει ανοιχτός. Είναι λοιπόν ένας έτερος τρόπος σε αυτή την κάποια λύση και θα σας προσκαλούσα να σκεφτείτε ένα άλλο ταξίδι που γίνεται από έναν άλλον ισακίσιο, επιτρέψτε μου αυτόν τον χαρακτηρισμό, που ακούει στο όνομα του Πολ Γκογκέν. Ο ζωγράφος φεύγει από τη Δανία, πάει στο Παρίσι, από το Παρίσι στη Βρετάνια, από τη Βρετάνια στην Προβυγγία, από την Προβυγγία στο μέσον του ωκεανού, ζωγραφίζοντας την ανάγκη για κάτι άλλο. Αν βάλετε παράλληλα το «Περιμένοντας τους βαρβάρους» και μία σειρά ζωγραφικών πινάκων του Πολ Γκογκέν, θα δείτε πώς το «esprit de temps», το πνεύμα μιας εποχής, εκπροσωπείται από δύο διαφορετικές τέχνες, που αυτό σημαίνει κάτι ιδιαίτερα για αυτό το γύρισμα του αιώνα ανάμεσα στο 19ο και στον 20ο. Και βέβαια, αν αυτά δεν τα κάνουμε, αν δεν ανοίξουμε τις πύλες, αν δεν δώσουμε τη δυνατότητα σε κάτι άλλο να μπει μέσα και να μας εμπλουτίσει, σε ένα έξω να μπει μέσα, τότε υπάρχουν κίνδυνοι και καταληκτικά πια στα 1928, εν μεγάλη ελληνική αποικία 200 π.Χ. διαπιστώνει, διαχρονικότατο είναι αυτό, ότι τα πράγματα δεν βαίνουν κατευχήν στην αποικία. Δεν μένει η ελαχίστη αμφιβολία. Και μόνο που οποσούν τραβούμε μπρος, ίσως, καθώς νομίζουν ούκο λίγοι, να έφτασε ο καιρός να φέρουμε πολιτικό αναμορφωτή. Μπορεί να είναι κάποιος από τους βαρβάρους ή κάποιος άλλος ή κάποιος ξένος, πάντως διαφορετικός από εμάς. Εδώ, κυρίες και κύριοι, είναι εξίσου προφανές ότι τόσο το «Περιμένοντας τους βαρβάρους» όσο και ο ζωγραφικός εξωτισμός του Πολ Γκογκέν τιμούν την αρχαϊκότητα, δηλαδή μια περιοχή του χρόνου όπου ο πολιτισμός είναι ανέπαφος από επιβαρύνσεις οι οποίες δεν δικαιολογούνται, δηλαδή αναζητείται εμέσως μία γνησιότητα με αυτά τα ταξίδια και των δύο. Δηλαδή, όταν μένουμε πολύ καιρό σε συμβατικότητες, χωρίς αυτές τις συμβατικότητες να τις σχετικοποιούμε, να τις εμπλουτίζουμε, τότε έχουμε το πρόβλημα του 200 π.Χ. Όλα αυτά τα αυθεντικά που πρέπει να κάνουμε κατά τον Καβάφη ανοιχνεύονται και στην ατομική μας ανησυχία, στο ένας γέρος που είναι κάποιος στο βάθος ενός καπηλιού που συλλογάται και από πρώτη άποψη θα μπορούσε να κανείς να πει ότι είναι μια προσωπική ανησυχία. Κοιτάξτε πόσο κοινωνικό είναι αυτό το ποίημα και συλλογέται η φρόνησης με το φι κεφαλαίο πως τον εγέλα και πως την εμπιστεύονταν πάντα τη φρόνηση. Τι τρέλα, τι ψεύτρα που έλεγε αύριο έχεις πολύ καιρό. Εδώ η φρόνηση δεν είναι γενικά η λογική. Το φι κεφαλαίο είναι μια εικαστική ηρωνία για τη φρόνηση ορισμένης εποχής, όπου η φρόνηση της κάθε εποχής μπορεί ή και επιβάλλεται να ξεπερνιέται. Και βεβαίως αρχίζει η αναζήτηση, ανάλογα και στη ζωγραφική, με τα παράθυρα. Επάνω κάτω τριγυρνώ για να βρω τα παράθυρα, να βγω έξω δηλαδή. Όταν ανοίγει ένα παράθυρο, θα είναι παρηγορία, νέα επιφύλαξη, νέος σχετικισμός. Ποιος ξέρει τι καινούρια πράγματα θα δείξει. Τίποτα δεν είναι βέβαιο στον καβαφικό λόγο, γι' αυτό η επιτεκτικότητά του είναι έκδηλα διακριτική ή αν θέλετε και λιγότερο έκδηλα, αλλά υπαρκτή. Θα σας έλεγα ότι εδώ, σε ό,τι αφορά αυτή την περίοδο και κοιτώντας τα παράθυρα, κοιτώντας τον Έντβαρ Μούνχ, το μεγάλο Νορβηγό που είναι και ο πραγματικός ιδρυτής του γερμανικού εξπρεσιονισμού. Να κάθεται στο παράθυρο και να κοιτάζει και να σκέφτεται και ταυτόχρονα στα 1952 η ίδια εικόνα του Μπαλτής που βάζει ένα κοριτσάκι να τραβήξει ένα παράθυρο για να μπει το έξω μέσα, επάλι έχουμε μία επιβεβαίωση αυτής της αναζήτησης που αρχίζει στο γύρισμα του αιώνα και συνεχίζεται. Και βεβαίως με ανάλογες εικονογραφικές ανησυχίες του μεγάλου Δανού του Βιλχαχάμερσχρόι, δεν είναι ιδιαίτερα γνωστός, αλλά η ζωγραφική του είναι μιας ανήσυχης ησυχίας. Όλα αυτά δίνονται με κάποια, ας πούμε, θεωρητική επικάλυψη. Μέχρι που να έρθει, μετά το 20, η συγκεκριμένη πραγματικότητα, η νέα αντικειμενικότητα στη ζωγραφική, αλλά και στην τέχνη γενικότερα, για να τα επιβεβαιώσει. Έτσι λοιπόν έχουμε μία συνέχεια διασωστικού εξωτισμού που θα κορυφωθεί με το υπόλοις, όπου η ατομική ευθύνη πλέον είναι έκδηλη και κατ' επέκταση και η συλλογική. Κάθε άτομο στον Καβάφη δεν είναι μόνο το άτομο, είναι αυτό που μπορεί να εκπροσωπήσει ως είδος, ως πολίτης. Είπες, θα πάγω σ' άλλη γη, θα πάγω σ' άλλη θάλασσα. Μια πόλη σ' άλλη θα βρεθεί καλύτερη από αυτή. Πάντα στην πόλη αυτή θα φθάνεις. Για τα αλλού μην ελπίζεις. Δεν έχει πλοίο για σένα. Δεν έχει οδό. Αλλά όλα αυτά μόνο μοιραία δεν είναι. Γιατί αναφέρονται στο δικό σου λάθος. Με αναφορά στην προσωπική ευθύνη αιτιολογούνται. Δεν δικαιολογούνται. Εκεί που τη ζωή σου ρήμαξες, εδώ στην κόχη τούτη τη μικρή, σ' όλη τη γη τη χάλασες. Είμαστε δηλαδή από δική μας καταλογιστέα αμέλεια τόσο κατηλημένοι από όσα εζήσαμε μέσα στα διάφορα τείχη, που δεν καταφέραμε να βγούμε, δεν ανοίξαμε τις πύλες, δεν κάναμε αυτό το οποίο έπρεπε, δεν κοιτάξαμε ίσως όσο έπρεπε στα παράθυρα, ποιήση, ζωγραφική και μουσική εδώ μαζί. Οπότε το μόνο που απομένει είναι ο μεγάλος διασωστικός, θα το έλεγα και διαφωτισμός ακόμα, είναι η Ιθάκη. Η Ιθάκη είναι ότι με τη γνώση, αν μπορέσεις να την αποκτήσεις, τότε με τη γνώση έχεις αρετή και συνεπώς τότε μπορεί να πας σε μια άλλη αυθεντικότερη συμβίωση. Αλλά για να γίνουν όλα αυτά, απαιτείται κάτι άλλο στην καβαφική φιλοσοφία. Πρέπει να διασφαλίσουμε μία ποιοτικά πιο αυτόνομη, άρα πάντα πιο υπεύθυνη και υψηλότερη ποιότητας, υψηλότερης ποιότητας ζωή. Γι' αυτό, με το όσο μπορείς, στα 1915 θα διαβάσουμε το διδακτικό λίγο μες στην πολλή συνάφεια του κόσμου, μες στις πολλές κινήσεις και ομιλίες τη ζωή. Μη την εξευτελίζεις, πιένοντάς την, γυρίζοντάς συχνά και εκθέτοντάς την, ώσπου να γίνει σαν μια ξένη φορτική. Πόσο επίκαιρο είναι αυτό. Ο εξωτισμός βέβαια εδώ παίρνει εκλεκτικές αποχρώσεις, γιατί τα τείχη, όπως σας είπα και λίγο πριν, δεν τα παραβιάσαμε ή δεν τα γκρεμίσαμε όπως έπρεπε. Αλλά αυτή η ανώτερη ποιότητα, αυτή η αυτονομία, ώστε να παραχθεί γνωστική επικουρία, απαιτείται να έρθει από κάποιους που γνωρίζουν, και ερχόμαστε τον ίδιο χρόνο στο Σοφί δε προσιόντων, όπου ο εκλεκτισμός συνεχίζεται εκ των μελώντων, οι σοφοί τα προσερχόμενα αντιλαμβάνονται. Αρκετά πλατωνικό αυτό. Ενώ εις την οδόν έξω η συνάφεια που λέγαμε πριν ουδέν ακούν οι λαοί. Φαίνεται λίγο αντιδημοκρατικό, αλλά είναι η επιταγή προς τη γνώση, ώστε ο καθένας να μπορεί με τα λόγου γνώσεως να διεκδικεί την ευτυχία του και τη συμμετοχή του στην κοινωνία. Μια σοκρατική ηθική είναι παρούσα. Και βέβαια, δανειζόμενος έναν τίτλο μιας εποχής αρκετά χαρακτηριστικής για το πόσο όλα αυτά κινούνται και διατρέχουν και άλλες σκέψεις και άλλες ανησυχίες, έχουμε τον τίτλο του «Si le prud'homme nous ne sont plus, nous ne sont pas oubliés, les roses», εδώ θα δείτε ότι φτάνουμε πλέον σε πράγματα τα οποία δεν δημοσιεύτηκαν όλα από την αρχή, με εκείνο το προεισαγωγικό σε σχέση με ένα άλλο, ότι εγώ, φοβούμενος τα τετριμένα, η συνάφεια του κόσμου πάλι, πολλούς μου λόγους αποσιωπώ. Εν την καρδία μου είναι γραμμένα πολλά ποίηματα και τα θαμμένα εκείνα άσματά μου αγαπώ. Για να αντιταχθεί στο τετριμένο, το οποίο θα το ζήσει εκείνη την εποχή με το ταξίδι του στην Ελλάδα, δηλαδή την παραμονή μέσα σε κλειστά σχήματα, εθνικά ή οποιαδήποτε άλλα, στα 1914, για να δείξει την ανάγκη εξόδου προς τα έξω, θα γράψει εκείνο το φαινομενικά κάπως αδιάφορο, ίσως ποίημα επικαιρότητας από το ταξίδι, αλλά δεν είναι έτσι, γιατί μια φιλοσοφία ετερότητας αρχίζει να διαγράφεται, θα γράψει εκείνο το «Σέλληνας σαν και εμάς δεν κάνουν τέτοιες μικροπρέπειες. Το αίμα της Συρίας και της Αιγύπτου που ρέει στις φλέβες μας, να μην τραπούμε να το τιμήσουμε και να το καυχηθούμε». Το Σέλληνας βέβαια δεν παραπέμπει σε μία βιολογική καταγωγή, αλλά παραπέμπει σε παιδεία και είναι μία, αν θέλετε, επαλήθευση του ότι ο Καβάφης είναι βαθύς αναγνώστης του Ντάντε Αλιγκιέρι, του ιδρυτή της παγκόσμιας κοινότητας και ιδρυτή πολιτικής φιλοσοφίας και πολιτικής θεωρίας. Είναι ο ίδιος λόγος, κυρίες και κύριοι, που ο Καβάφης δεν επεφύλαξε πολύ καλή υποδοχή εις τον Φιλίππο Τομάζο Μαρινέτη, όταν τον επισκέφθηκε στην Αλεξάνδρεια, μια άλλη φιλοπολεμική φιλοσοφία ενάντια στην ειρήνη που μέσα από τη Θεία Κωμωδία προκύπτει. Βέβαια, όλα αυτά τα τετριμένα θα αναλυφθούν εκ νέου με το μεγάλο ποίημα που δημοσιεύτηκε αργότερα, τα Κρυμμένα. Το ξέρετε όλοι, αλλά έχω κάποιο λόγο που θα μου επιτρέψετε να σας το τιμήσω και θα δείτε γιατί. Σε αυτό μένω μόνο σε δύο στροφές. Οι πιο απαρατήρητες μου πράξεις και τα γραψίματά μου τα πιο σκεπασμένα, από εκεί μονάχα θα με νιώσω. Κατόπιν, στην τελειωτέρα κοινωνία, κανένας άλλος καμωμένος σαν εμένα βέβαια θα φανεί και ελεύθερα θα κάνει. Αυτή η γκρίζα αισιοδοξία, μία ψυχολαχθέ στην πραγματικότητα, στο μυαλό του Καβάφη, είναι μια υπονομευμένη καλοκαιρία, αλλά καλοκαιρία του μέλλοντος, δεν είναι του παρόντος του. Συνεπώς, επανέρχεται η στάση της διαμαρτυρίας. Έχω την εντύπωση ότι αυτό το ποίημα θα μπορούσε να θεωρηθεί ότι γειτνιάζει πολύ, χωρίς να είναι αντιγραφή, με ένα άλλο που γράφτηκε από κάποιον άλλον 50 χρόνια νωρίτερα, στα 1851. Κρατήστε τα τετριμένα, κρατήστε τα κρυμμένα στο μυαλό σας και ακούστε αυτό το λόγο. «Αλίμονος σε κιόν που δια του πνεύματος ξαπεράσει οποσούν την εποχή του. Βαριά καταφορά δημοσίου ρεύματος θαν του καταπικράνει τη ζωή του. Μαν ακόμη βαλθεί εξ επιτιδεύματος, εξ επαγγέλματος, να φέρει εμπρός την κοινωνία μαζί του, τότε ολόκληρη αυτή, σαν απονεύματος, θε να πέσει στην άθλια ύπαρξή του. Θα τον αποστραφεί με ατιμασία, τότε η μωρή και αχάριστη πατρίδα και μέσα στην όλη αποδοκιμασία δε θα έχει μη την άχαρη ελπίδα να έρθει άλλη γενεά, όπως τον Καβάφη, με νοημοσύνη να του κάνει μια μέρα δικαιοσύνη». Αυτά γράφονται στα 1851 από κάποιον όπου στα 1851 είναι εξωελλαδικός, όπως ο Καβάφης, και μετά βέβαια θα γίνει ελλαδικός και θα αφορεστεί. Είναι ο Ανδρέας Λασκαράτος. Αυτά συνέβαιναν, κυρίες και κύριοι, στο γύρισμα, το παραταμένο γύρισμα του 19ου προς τον 20ο αιώνα, που υπό κάποια έννοια συνηθίζεται να μας απασχολεί κάπως παραπάνω ίσως από ό,τι πρέπει μερικές φορές, αλλά είναι αναγκαίο, και που επίσης αυτό το γύρισμα θα μπορούσε να πει κανείς ότι θα πρέπει να μας απασχολήσει και ως γύρισμα από τον 20ο στον 21ο αιώνα. Σήμερα δηλαδή πολλά από αυτά συνεχίζουμε να τα ζούμε, μόνο που το κάνουμε χωρίς περίσκεψη, νομίζουμε, χωρίς λύπη, χωρίς εδώ. Ίσως αυτή την τοποθέτηση, θέλετε να την πούμε έτσι, ή θέλετε να την πούμε καλύτερα, αυτή την ηθική, να την υιοθετεί ο Νίκος Καζαντζάκης όταν αργότερα θα γράψει ότι εγώ γράφω για τους μελόμενους νέους. Η διαμαρτυρία στο παρόν είναι δεδομένη, η ελπίδα στο μεθαύριο ή και παραπέρα είναι επίσης δεδομένη. Δεν έχω παρά να σας ευχαριστήσω που με ακούσατε.
Professor Peter Mackridge will talk to us on the translation of Cavafy's poems by Evangelos Achperoulou.
Good evening. I'd like to thank the organizers very much for inviting me to say a few words about Evangelos Achperoulou's translations of Cavafy's poems. Unfortunately, for health reasons, Evangelos isn't able to be with us tonight, but I'd like to wish him publicly Kali Anarosi. It's the Sakperoglu translation that Professor Yerulanos has used in his new book, which we see at the back of this room. And in fact, it's Sakperoglu's translations that we see all around us in this room this evening. His translation of the 155 poems of Cavafy's approved poems, the poems that Cavafy approved at his death, first appeared in a privately published volume in Athens in 2003. When first I read these translations, I was impressed by the way Sakperoglu managed to convey the Alexandrian poet's tone of voice so faithfully. I had the impression that I was hearing Cavafy himself reciting his poems. A few months later, I took part in an event entitled Cavafy's Voices here at the Hellenic Centre. The event consisted of a talk by me, followed by readings of Cavafy's poems in Greek by the actor Kostas Kastanas. The topic of my talk then was close to the theme of this evening's recital and tomorrow's conference at King's College, namely Cavafy's references to voices and music, the voices of various historical and fictional characters who speak in his poems, and in general, the vocal and oral aspects of his poetry. Since many of the audience then, on that occasion, didn't know Greek, I decided to hand out photocopies of the relevant poems in Evangelos Sakperoglu's translation. And afterwards, many members of the audience came up to me and told me how much they'd appreciated these translations, and this urged me, as it were, to take the matter further. And with Evangelos's encouragement, I approached Oxford University Press with a proposal that they publish his translation with an introduction by me. I told the editor at the press that it would be best if the poems were to appear in the original Greek as well as in English translation. And the press accepted my proposal, and I decided to invite Anthony Hurst, who's also here this evening, who at the time was preparing a critical edition of Cavafy's poetry, to provide an edition of the text. So the text that you see in the Oxford collection is edited by Anthony Hurst. This is a text based on the last version of each poem as printed and approved by Cavafy himself. Sorry. I've got technology in my way. I'm not using it, but it's there. So Anthony's edition of the poems that you find on the left-hand side of the page in this edition is a meticulous text that differs in some respects, some small details, from the Greek versions of the Cavafy poetry that have appeared before. Our volume, Introduction, Greek Text, the Sakperoglu Translation and Some Brief Explanatory Notes, appeared in the Oxford World's Classics series in 2007. In this series, which consists of 800 of the greatest works of the world's literature, philosophy, history, and religion, Cavafy finds himself rubbing shoulders with Julius Caesar, Dante, Jonathan Swift, Jane Austen, Charles Dickens, Lewis Carroll, Charles Darwin, Sigmund Freud, and Karl Marx, and many others. Cavafy is the most recent Greek author to be included in Oxford World's Classics, after Plutarch and Lucian. I'm sure Cavafy would be delighted to be in such distinguished company, and given his status as a world classic, it's appropriate that some of his colleagues in the series have already appeared, either as characters or as quoted writers, in Cavafy's poems. The Athens launch of our volume took place at an event in 2008, organised by Professor and Mrs. Gerolanos at the American School of Classical Studies in Athens, to celebrate the 75th anniversary of Cavafy's death. For me, the high point of the evening was hearing Claire Bloom reading some of Evangelos Sakperoglu's translations. The English actress really made the poems come alive as she channeled them through her rich, smooth voice. Claire Bloom demonstrated how successfully Evangelos' translations lend themselves to oral performance, as I'm sure Jeremy Irons will do tomorrow. Since the publication of our volume, Evangelos has completed the translation of the rest of Cavafy's poems, that is, the poems that the poet did not finally approve for publication. Some of these translations appear in Professor Yelvananos' new book, and some of them are on the walls here. And I very much hope that a complete set of Evangelos' translations of Cavafy will be published before long. It's often said as a rule, stated as a rule, that one should not translate from one's own language into a foreign one. Cavafy is one of the most frequently translated writers in world literature. And it's rather extraordinary that as many as seven translations of his collected poems in English, approximately half of the total number, have been done by people whose native language is Greek. Some of the translations by Greeks seem to me to confirm the justice of the rule that I've just mentioned, but Evangelos Sakperoglou's translations are a notable exception. Cavafy spent 5 years of his childhood in London and Liverpool, and in this way he became bilingual in English and Greek. But he always spoke English with a slight Greek accent. It's probable also that he spoke Greek with a slight foreign timbre, since he spent most of his life in Alexandria and only made a few brief visits to Athens, to Greece. Also, since both of his parents were from Constantinople, and he spent 3 formative years in that city between the ages of 18 and 21, his spoken Greek contained traces of Constantinople Greek, some of which passed into the vocabulary and grammar of his poetry, for instance, komati ochro, a little pale, and tonelose morphin, not tuelose morphin. This is one reason why an English translation of his poetry by a non-native speaker of English should not, in principle, be a bad thing. The language of Cavafy's poetry isn't the systematic demotic that became standard in Greek poetry in the late 19th and early 20th centuries in poets such as Palamas. His language mixes vocabulary and grammatical forms that belong to the spoken language with vocabulary and forms that were current in antiquity. This is in keeping with the subject matter of his poems set in ancient times. But it means that it's slightly out of kilter with the language of other poets, other Greek poets of his time. So Cavafy's language differed from the standard poetic Greek language of his day, both in respect of its regionalism and in respect of its archaism. And it's for this reason that I have the impression that the English of the Sakperoglou translation resembles the English spoken by Cavafy, and that Cavafy would have used a very similar language had he written his poems in English. The language of Sakperoglou's translation is a highly cultivated and refined variety of English. Some might find it slightly old-fashioned, but with a slightly Mediterranean accent and with Greek rhythms and tones. The translation adheres closely to the original text and conveys the tight structure of the versification and rhythm of Cavafy's poetic voice, something which is often lost in other translations. The translator has tried to preserve the word order of the original as far as this is possible in English, and in many of the poems he's preserved the meter and rhythm of the original text. Some theorists of translation now contest the rule that if a translation is to function effectively, it must be indistinguishable from a poem written in the target language. In other words, that a poem has to be entirely domesticated to the tastes of the target audience. On the contrary, these theorists support the view that a translation should convey the foreignness of the original. And it seems to me that Sakperoglou's translation steers a course between these extreme views. Miden agan Auguste, nothing in excess, Augustus, as Cavafy's anonymous speaker says to the Emperor Julian. Thank you.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I should have stopped before starting, so I'll try my best. And after this fantastic thinkers, you have to do now with the manual worker. The two photographs between Cavafy and the coin gives an impression that is somehow a connection. But how comes that 70 years after his death, nobody has realized that this was real? I was for the International Red Cross on the Himalaya in Peshawar trying to solve the convoy to the Taliban at that time before they became the government. And there I bought in a little shop in the Agora of Peshawar 3 coins. I've never been. I had a very good friend, Vasily Dimitriadi, that was collecting coins. We had some coins from the farm in Trachonis, but I've never seen the really I had in my hands coins. And I saw these coins on one side, a king with Greek inscriptions, on the other side, Athena or horsemen with Karossi. And I said, that's peculiar, they might be fake. But he looked, showed me a book and said, no, they are real. At the end, they were fake, but they were copying correct ones. And then the three names that I had in my hands were going through my head, Menandros Ermeos Efkratidis, Efkratidis Ermeos Menandros, etc., etc. And suddenly I thought it must be Cavafy. I looked at all his poems, I couldn't find anything. And suddenly Nada comes in the library. I make like that, I open a book, and I fall on these poems. Coins with Indian inscriptions, they are of the Midas monarchs, Evukratunazo, Strataga, Menandraza, Ramayaza. But he also depicts the other side, which is the principal one, with the image of the king, and here how a Greek stops at once, how he is touched to read in Greek, Hermeos Efkratidis, Straton Menandros. I didn't buy Straton, so I could not make immediately the connection. But when I saw that, I said, but if he has seen this seldom once, he must have seen Antiochus Epiphanes, he must have seen Cleopatra, he must have seen Dimitrios Sotir. Oh, I will make a lovely publication, 30 poems of Cavafy illustrated. But it came completely different, because instead of only this 15 once or 30 or 50, more and more, and even today I've put one new coin there of Hannibalianus that is mentioned in his poems. And they are definitely going to come more. But look at this poem to Antiochus Epiphanes. Okay, Antiochus Epiphanes, there he is. But at once he remembered his father and his brother. Who is his father? Antiochus III. Who is his brother? Selefkos IV. It was peculiar. And suddenly, a geographical word was there. Pydna. In Pydna, what had happened? The Macedonians lost to the Romans. It was Persois that fled to Samothrake, and there Aemilius Paulus got him, and now he is sent to Rome as a prisoner with his two sons. Has he seen these coins? It's a question. When you go to Episcopos Pigasios, an unfinished poem, he gives it a second name, Onaustis Athenas. Many, 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 many coins with Athena from Ilion, from Troia. I haven't found yet the temple with Athena inside. I hope I'll do it. And then I had this picture in my collection from Leiden. On a wall in Leiden, there is a poem of Cavafy in Greek called Crimena. You have heard it before from Professor Metaxas, and my most veiled writings from these alone will I be understood. And then another thing, many poets are just poets. Palamas is not only a poet, he has written normal writings. Porphyras is a clear poet. I had two statuses, to craft poems and to write history. I am a historian poet. Why does he write that? And he says it into three different persons, we have this evidence. And then he says, I make the experiments and I ask myself, Cavafy, can you write a novel? 10 voices yell me, no. I ask the question again, Cavafy, can you write a play? 25 voices yell me, no. I ask the question again, Cavafy, can you write history? 125 voices telling, yes, you can. So there is a site which we knew that one third of his poems are historical, but did he really intend to write history? I asked him personally, did you want to write history? And the answer was always yes and no. And the yes is clear. He writes a history of the Hellenic nation from the early antiquity mythology to the fall of Constantinople. And here unites with Bethany a big passion with Istanbul's of today. And then I was an innocent, I was a Cavafy friend, but nothing to do with philology. I didn't know when he wrote the one poem, when the others. All the books you find, you'll see them 1913 to 1915, 1915 to 22, etc. I put them on the historical order. And what comes out is very peculiar, that he has gone systematically. He has, most of the groups are 6 to 8 poems, except of Julian, there are 12, and there are 3 Judaic and 3 Italiotic. All the rest is the Byzantines are 666, and we'll see afterwards how much. And then I took the tree of the Ptolemies and I said, let's see whom has he mentioned in his poems. And you see yellow are all the men, and practically is no one left except of the father of Cleopatra. The woman he mentions with 2 verbs, this Veronicus and Cleopatras. Finished, and you have all the red ones, all the Veronicus and the Cleopatras with 2 words, he covers the whole thing. But even he goes here to the Domus Julia, the house of Julius Caesar, and you see again, he goes systematically. It is not by chance, these things. But why is there no? Because he doesn't write a history. He writes an anti-history with anti-heroes. He does not take Themistocles at his great moments in Salamis, but, and what frightful day when you give in and you depart, a wayfarer for Susa, and you go to the monarch Artaxerxes. And here is the wayfarer, Themistocles. He's probably one of the first that has struck coins with his face and his name. And we see also here the theta epsilon, Themistocles. And when we see Dimitrios Poliorcetes, he's not in Rhodes when he tries to conquer the city walls, but when his army left him and went to Pyrrhus, and he went ahead and took off his golden garments and threw away his royal purple shoes. So he shows the weak side of the people, and not Constantine the Great in his great honors when he builds Constantinople, but when he is the little man or his soldiers kill family. But his history is not only an anti-history with anti-heroes. It is much, much more. Cavafy follows exactly Aristotle's principles for poetry in his poetics. Poetry is not rendering history in verses, writes Aristotle. The historian cannot ignore major facts or incidents. He can describe them subjectively, but he has to mention them. You cannot forget Marathon or Salamis or Actium, etc. You have, as a historian, to mention them. In contrast, the poet can move himself between the historical events. He can enter into small crevices or clefts between the big historical events and enlighten them by his way. The historian describes what happened, in contrast, the poet describes what could or must have happened. Let's see it with Aiellaos. Let's not have Greeks vague war against other Greeks anymore. O King Philip, think of all Greeks as your king. If you are desirous of war, prepare yourself to face whomever will be the winner in Italy. This is not the time to fight each other. O King Philip, save Greece, wise words that came to nothing. During the dreadful, accused days of Kinokephale, of Magnesia, of Pydna, many of the Greeks thought back of these wise words that came to nothing. The historian, as I said, describes what happened. In contrast, the poet describes what could or should have happened in this case. The poet is, in contrast to the historian, a creator. And I don't dare to write what he writes about the historian's Aristoteles. That's why poetry is more philosophic and more important than history. I think he follows completely these directions to show what should happen and not what has happened. The deep knowledge of history gave Cavafy the possibility to engender the hidden feelings behind the historical facts. Through the reciprocal influence between the indisputable facts and the feelings, Cavafy gives to the past another dimension. The historical moment becomes timeless. It becomes simultaneously yesterday, today, and tomorrow. That's extremely important, and we will see why some of his poems stayed unpublished. It's clearly that he has written only the yesterday, but not made the connection, the click to tomorrow. Let's look at this poem, which is a unique, for my opinion. I will turn, it's a person that comes from Alexandria. He has seen the Ptolemies, knows a bit of military, and comes back to Syria and says, I'll turn to Sabinas first, or I'll turn to Teresa May or Alexis. It's just the same. And if that moron does not appreciate me, I'm off to his adversary Grypos, Jeremy Corbyn, Kyriakos, whatever you want. And if that idiot too won't employ me, I'll go right away to Irkanos, Tim Farron, or Fotini. Anyway, one of the three should take me on. And my conscience is at peace about the random nature of my choice. All three of them are equally harmful for Greece, for Great Britain, etc. But a ruined man, how am I to blame? I'm trying, poor wretch, to make ends meet. If only the almighty gods had seen to it and had created a fourth man, a good one, happily I would have sided with him. It is the Volta. Cavafy succeeds to identify us with his heroes, as Seferis writes. I think that's also one extremely important. And as I said, many poets are just poets. I am a historical poet, a historian poet. Now, to the book, Historia Arcana. I'm sorry to say, I haven't done anything. The book was a translation of the Greek one. The Greek was the original for the exhibition that we made in Vienna. It made 350,000 visitors, so that's not bad. It was a bit better than here, but with original coins. But the translation is unique by Alexandra Dumas, not Alexander Dumas. But she is the wife of Christos Dumas, who excavated Santorini. And she is unique in translation. I came across to Cavafy very, very peculiar. They sent me from Germany a book, translation in German of Cavafy, and I should criticize. And it was a catastrophe, but really a catastrophe. You can't imagine the translation. I couldn't write that. So I said, how can I come out? They insisted that I write it, and so I said, okay. I took three English translation, three German translations, and I compared the six. And put the German as the last one, but it was peculiar that Tsakperoglu's translation was speaking much more to me. I don't know if it was better, as Peter Margaret said, but it was different. And why it was different? Because he has the iamb in the English verses. The iamb and this irregular iamb that Cavafy uses that comes out, and sometimes some words that are of double meaning that are coming better out that, than in other translation. He has written 150 that are in the canon, 27 he has thrown out. If you translate them, he has thrown them out because of the language, it was Katharebusa. But if you translate them in English, they are exactly as the other, as good as the other. The unpublished, exactly the same, and the unfinished, Lavanini has done a marvelous work and put them together, and they are unique. One third are historical, one third didactic, one third sensual or erotic, as Savidis said. I come to 50-50. One fourth ancient Greek, one fourth Hellenistic, Greco-Roman, Byzantine. And he has given very early to some groups ancient days, sorry, Hellenistic days, Christian days and Byzantines, I have added the Roman days in. Don't look at the Greek, just look at the numbers. You see the 7777. The groups have just seven poems, and the Judaic and the Italiotic three. Three and seven are the holy numbers in antiquity. Was he intending to write for every group that he was preparing seven poems? Some of them were eight, or with Julian are 12. 12 is also a holy number. So we are not sure, I don't know. You see here the Roman, the Julian, and the Byzantine 666. And Cavafy's history ends with the fall of Constantinople. The last coin we have is from Constantine, the 11th Paleologos, who lost the town with Mehmed the Conqueror. And there is only one other poem, more a folkloric poem from Trabzon, where a bird, a pigeon, brings the news that Istanbul, Constantinople, was taken. He writes nothing about 400 years of Turkish occupation, nothing of the Greek Revolution, nothing of the Balkan Wars, Greece doubled at that time, nothing of the World War I, nothing of the catastrophes. 97 or 22, nothing of the bankruptcies that he was working with money, etc. Cavafy's history is the history of the Hellenic nation, not of Greece. For Cavafy, Hellenism is lost from the moment that Greece was geographically reduced to today's borders. For him, a Greek of the diaspora, Hellenes are all the Greeks in any place of the world. Professor Metaxas has shown it much better. For him, Hellas has no borders. Now, when we look at him and we take all 298 poems together, 145 are historical. Of these, 105 include historical persons, 99 include historical persons depicted on coins, 40 others are potentially historical, not included in this book, and most of them are considered essential. From the 99 poems in the book are 152 historical persons, 139 are depicted on coins. Is this by random? Can't be. He must have seen them. 13 are not depicted on coins, like Herodes Atticus, like the prince of Western Libya, etc. Did he see the coins? What we know is only that he has described coins in at least five of his poems. But we don't know where he has seen them. The obvious thing is 500 meters from his house is the Museum of Alexandria, so he was going there and looking at them. However, Oroferni's, there are only two coins in the world, one in the British Museum, one in Cabinet de Médailles in Paris. Did he see them there? And he writes, he's smiling. When you look at him, he's not smiling. Everything is not possible. But
he declares it very beautifully. He who appears upon the tetradagar with a hint of a smile on his face, his beautiful, delicate face, he is Orofernes, son of Ariarathes. As I said, British Museum, Cabinet de Metal, but there is also a book of 1897 that he has seen. The poem was written in 1904, 7 years later, and we have here Orofernes, and we have here Mithridates, that you have him also there, yeah. And I think it is this book that he has seen it, as 60 of his heroes, of 139 heroes depicted on coins and mentioned in his poems, can be observed in this booklet, which includes 358 coins. But not Ariarathes. He mentions Ariarathes, but he's not in there, so he must have seen him somewhere else. And this is, I think, the most important thing that I've done in this work. You see here the poem, a slave and a servant. It's the same person, bent on the same task, without any joy for 40 long years. He heaps upon the coins upon the table the new coins minted by the state of Nicaea. He picks them up and counts them one by one. And with his aged out eyesight, he examines whether the inscription is correct. One more mistake and he'd be tortured, they've told him. And so his hands are trembling. But otherwise, in the reign of Severus, the people prospered. Again, I couldn't find. Lavanini says it is Alexander Severus. I looked, all his coins, I couldn't find anything. And then again, Nada came in. I opened the history of the Hellenic nation. I make like that, and this comes Felicitas Seculi. I say, oh, that's it. On the other side is Septimius Severus, that you see him here. I say, that's it, it's Septimius Severus. But these signs, before and after, I couldn't accept that the Felicitas Seculi, he would have put it Felicitas Seculi in and written it in French or in English. And then I was in Cincinnati at the Blegen Library for a lecture series, and they were proud, we have everything on the computer, all the library, the biggest Greek library that exists in the world, I would say. Say, okay, let's put in the words Severu Vasilevontos o Kosmos. Prop, 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 he puts it in. They go to the fifth floor, this thing, there you find the book where it is written in, and I find the book and says, Severu Vasilevontos o Kosmos Eftichi, Makari in Nicomidis. It took me another 2 years to find the coin. And you see it, here you have two temples, Severu Vasilevontos, TOS. Ο κόσμος ευτυχή, but he με γιώτα, not with epsilon γιώτα, μα κα, R and I missing, μακάρι Νικομιδής. But he writes Νικαία, not Νικομίδια. It could go in the worse than Νικομίδια. So probably he has seen a coin that it was destroyed, the M and I and the delta. And it was Νικαίης that he tried to think that was behind. This probably is in Alexandria, but I haven't detected. Now, we need somebody that has a bit more qualities than I have. I'm, as I said, a manual worker, but we need a specialist. And we need also a teacher for him, because it's unbelievable what's going to come out if somebody puts more in. We need somebody that takes only the historical herb. He has to be a historian, a philologist, and has a character not like me. He has to be workaholic, talented, broad-minded, poetic, sensitive, loving books and library, extremely exact, alternative thinking, and cross-linking ability. Just check these things. Don't see what notes he has. Just the character is much more important. And he will have a rewarding end. He will be able to prove that Cavafy was a player, a unique history showing to the world how open and liberal the antique world was. The freedom
of the antiquity. And I think this comes through his poems. And when he puts the rest of the historic, look, Chaldean image, Pelasgian image, Indic image, eternity, the tears of the sisters Phaethon, when the watchman saw the light of Troia, that Troia was conquered. When he puts Herodes Atticus, Western Libya, the first steps, etc., etc. Or Clito's illness from the school of the famous philosopher Ammonius Acast. Here we have data. These are historical poems, they are not sensual poems. They are for, in purpose put the third century. He could have put something else. And look here, these are all, except of the three ones up, all the others are sensual. 340, 4 for 400, 500, 600. These are historicals. I think that it was easy for him to write the sensual ones at that time that he was writing, and he was not able historically to make the historical side at this time. I think this will be the unfinished one. Or we have again seven funeral stelae and one epitaph of Antiochus Comagene. We have cities that have coins. And the unpleasant side of the book is that the coins are unfortunately mentioned in the end. At the exhibition in Vienna, we're next to the poems and it was easier. But the coins, we have put them with the poems. And what is for the layman important is that on the left side, you have on one side the literary data, the historical and the geographical. Where is Prata? Where is Zagros? For many of the readers, it's something far away, but where are they? So we have, it has a certain importance in the poems of Cavafy. It is not by chance that he throws the word Zagros or Frata or whatever else it is. And enjoy then, especially this first verse. The gods don't die. Then αποθνίσκουν οι θεοί. Η πίστης αποθνίσκει του αχαρίστου όχλου των θνητών. Είναι οι θεοί αθάνατοι. And you see them in their form. Here, Zeus, and here, Constantine Paleologos. Thank you very much.
Already as a student at the Athens Conservatoire, at the age of 14, Mitropoulos wanted to become a composer. Having received his diploma in 1919, and after a brief stay in Brussels, he studied composition in Berlin with Ferruccio Busoni, and worked as corepetitor and assistant conductor, thus familiarizing himself with the latest musical trends. Mitropoulos' song cycle 14 Invenzioni was composed after his repatriation in 1924, and before his definitive commitment to conducting. All evidence leads us to the two dates between which the composer studied Cavafy's poems and composed his work, from February to July 1925. The manuscript of the Cavafy songs is held in the Mitropoulos archives of the Gennadios Library in Athens, and the first public performance of the 10 inventions that we are going to perform tonight took place in Athens on June 5, 1927, sung by soprano Poppy Sertiu. A private performance in the presence of the poet took place in 1932, in which Mitropoulos sang the songs, accompanying himself on the piano. The publication of the score of the Mitropoulos Cavafy inventions, also including the French translations, is not dated and comprises only 10 of the poems. We do, however, assume that the score has circulated in 1927. The exact reason for which only 10 movements are included in the score is not known to us. From then on, the song cycle appeared in this condensed form, and the original handwritten version of 14 Invenzioni was until recently discarded and only existed in an archival file. With Mr. Giovannakis, we first performed the 10 inventions at the Kunsthistorisches Museum in Vienna, within the frame of the Metropolis Cavafy project, with the precious collaboration of Ms. Nada Gerulanos and Professor Stefanos Gerulanos. In 2006, further performances include concerts at the Gionavius Library, Cotton Hall, the Theoharakis Foundation for Arts and Music, the Grand Ceremony Hall of the University of Macedonia, upon invitation of the UNESCO Chair of International and European Studies in Greece, the Melina Mercouri Hall in Thessaloniki, within the frame of the Hellenic Music Festivities, the Zapion Megaron Hall in Athens, within the frame of the presentation of Professor Stefanos Gerulanos' book, C.P. Cavafy, Historia Arcana, A Hidden History, under the auspices of the Hellenic Presidency of the EU Council. In 2014, the original 14 Invenzioni cycle was published in 2010 from the Hellenic Music Research Lab of the Music Department of the Ionian University, thanks to the tireless academic research of musicologist, composer, and director of the lab, Professor Haris Xanthoudakis, followed by the world premiere we gave with Mr. Giovannakis in February 10 at the Megaron Athens Concert Hall, and further concerts in Greece and the Opera House in Cairo, Egypt. Also, Belgian choreographer and co-director of Maurice Béjart Ballet of the 20th Century, Daniel Lommel, choreographed a dance performance with Aenon Dance Theatre of the complete form of the 14 Invenzioni, performed live at the Municipal Theatre of Corfu. A world premiere recording followed the same year in Paris. The CD also contains two songs, Pan and Heavenly Aphrodite, on poems by Angelos Sikelianos, written earlier, probably while the composer was still living in Berlin. It is not our aim tonight to discuss in detail the technical aspects of melodic recitation. Nevertheless, a very brief citation of some important elements seen from the performer's point of view can offer an indication of the originality of Mitropoulos' work. Having performed many times Arnold Schoenberg's emblematic work, Pierrot Lunaire, from the very first time I looked at the score of Inventions, it was apparent that Mitropoulos chose Pierrot as a model and point of reference for his work, possibly with the aim of suggesting a national route towards international modernism, to cite Haris Xanthoudakis. In the foreword of the first edition of Pierrot, Schoenberg gives very specific instructions to the performer regarding what she should do, or better, what she should not do in order to perform the music according to the composer's intentions, thus introducing a new era in the use of the voice, delineating the technical characteristics of Sprechgesang. The melody, writes Schoenberg, given in notation in the vocal part, is not intended to be sung. The performer has the task of transforming it into a speech melody, taking the prescribed pitches carefully into account. In introducing his inventions, Mitropoulos says, each of these poems has as its basis a different formal structure in which the voice, the reciter of the poem, is but an atom of the structure. It is not a song, but neither a dry recitation with accompaniment. One should neither sing them or simply recite them, but rather something between the two, perhaps a stylized form of recitation. In order to make the difference between ordinary speech and speech that collaborates in a musical form clear, Mitropoulos chooses very carefully the tessitura, the vocal range, of the whole cycle, which allows him to replace both speech and song through the vocal quality of Sprechgesang. This method of recitation of the Cavafy settings inevitably leads to an almost Brechtian distancing of the singer-reciter, which emphasizes the fact that the poetic description of pleasure by Cavafy often appears distant and faded by the passing of time. Two other essential elements of the performance of the Mitropoulos-Cavafy song cycle that pose a challenging target to the singer are precision and clarity in diction, following with great exactness all the nuances and various colors indicated by the composer, and keeping the exact intonation, maintaining without the slightest alteration the precise pitch. Throughout the entire cycle, the vocal line develops from the text and is generated from the speech intonation and the sonic properties of the Greek language. Vowel pitch and length, rhythm, the smoothness or explosiveness of the various combination of consonants, as well as from this position and shape and tension that the vocal organs must adopt to pronounce a word. As the great singer Lily Lehmann points out in her book, How to Sing, the mixing and connecting of several vowels in the different vowel forms on single tone is a study in itself. To begin with, we must try clearly to understand that every letter demands its own form, that every union of the vocal organs from one letter to the other must again create a new form, or better, a new quality of the form. The 14 Invenzioni are, historically, the first setting of poems by Constantine Cavafy. And, in my opinion, this song cycle is the closest existing musical work to the atmosphere and to the real content of Cavafy's poems. "You will be astonished," Mitropoulos wrote to the poet in July 1926, "at the courage I have shown in my choice of your songs. Yet, besides all my fears, the music is so appropriate for this type of meter and atmosphere that I can assure you it was liked by even the most moralist of people." At this point, I think I will stop talking and we'll start singing. Let the music of Dimitri Mitropoulos carry us into the landscape of the inner world of Konstantinos Cavafis. Thank you.